What's up, everybody? Oh, shoot.
Pause this.
What's up, everybody? So today we have another chapter to discuss on subtle sound, the Zen teachings of Maureen Stewart. So for those that haven't been following along, we've discussed the first 8 chapters. We have the little bookmarks highlighted throughout each chapter. I also try and give a second or two of me showing these pages as I go through them. That way, if you care to, you can actually pause this. You should be able to read this full page. That's just if you want to read it. Otherwise, we'll go ahead and get started here. Shout out to Harry Potter, because this book is Tom Riddled, which means it has all the highlights. So on this first thing, it says, on April 8th, Buddha's birthday, we celebrated 15 with 15 so-called children and 30 other children of all older ages and stages. I told this Buddha story and being the little prince in the little state in India. Yeah, I don't know if any of you have ever heard the story of Buddha, but it's actually a pretty interesting story. I guess he was some prince, kind of like, I don't try and relate everything to the Dark Knight, but it's kind of like how in the Dark Knight, how, what's his name? He's like, you're the Prince of Gotham. You've never known, Falcone or I forgot who it was. The mobster was like, yeah, you've never known like the true struggle of life. Like you're Bruce Wayne, you're the Prince of Gotham. He's like, so don't come down here with your problems. He's like, this world you never understand, and you always fear what you don't understand or what you can't understand. And so what's interesting about this is like the Buddha's story is kind of like how Bruce Wayne had left. The Buddha had left. He had never known anything outside of his royal grounds. And when he lived in the royal grounds, he had everything he ever wanted, and everything was at a call away. And so when he left, kind of like when Bruce Wayne left the Palisades and went out and left Wayne Manor, he left and went to like Malaysia or Mongolia or somewhere probably similar to where the Buddha was, and he had to like live with nothing to ultimately try and figure out what it all meant to have access to so much. And so the Buddha ended up just leaving, and I know it's a pretty interesting story. You should check it out. Everyone is the noblest one. You, I, and everything in the universe, here, there, everything is nothing but the noblest one. Nice part. I like this part right here. Every day is a good day. It's true. Every day is a good day. If for some reason, when clouds come, what? Cloudiness. When rain comes, raininess. As Ummin said with stunning simplicity, every day is a good day. It is when our discriminating minds interfere that we have trouble. That's a great line. Every day is a good day. It is when our discriminating minds interfere that we have trouble. Oh, this is a short chapter too. Well, class, you guys got a little bit of a shorter class here. My Spanish class has been running long. If you're interested in learning Spanish with me, you can check out those videos on my channel as well. I'm doing those daily. We're about halfway through it now, roughly. Once we get through this, if someone wants this book, I'll send it to him. If not, I'm just going to give it to a buddy of mine. She's actually from Cambridge, it says. She was a guiding teacher of the Cambridge Buddhist Association in Cambridge, Mass. She died in 1990, so 2 years before I was born, but her reputation as a teacher of great practicality, humor, and compassion has grown far beyond her original circle of students. Hey, shout out to you, Maureen Stewart. Maureen Stewart, she was a hip lady, okay? She was a hip lady. She was a lot like Martha, she's a lot like Martha Washington. When she'd come home, George... Never mind. Anyway, so let's get to this next part. What is it like to depend on ourselves alone, on our own experience? We must come to understand that we are part of a whole universe, not some separate self. We are here to practice together deeply, clearly, and to live without saying one word about it. It's interesting. Something I'll tell you, and it's, if you're watching this video, there's a good chance you already know, but I'll say it for those people who might just stumble into this video and kind of wonder what this is all about. I find it interesting because, and tomorrow we actually have chapter 10, the circumstances teaching. So we'll talk about this chapter though for a second here. Depending on nothing, right? Is the name of the chapter. And that last part, I'll read it once more. We are here to practice together deeply and clearly and to live it without saying one word about it. We are certainly not doing this in order to really say, my life is so much better since I started doing Zen practice. Nonsense. So it is, but there is no need to say so. That's where I thought that was going. It's interesting. If you're watching this video, there's a good chance you already feel this way. But if you are like stumbled in onto it, like I said, there's this interesting, I guess, thought I had about meditating and about the whole practice of just meditation, of trying to be more spiritually sound, like the whole. Imagine like physical fitness, right? Like everything that goes into physical fitness in a way. Like if you want to get muscles, yeah, you need to eat right. Yes, definitely. But the main thing with getting muscles is actually working out. And it's like the same thing with spiritual wellness and like your spiritual health. It's like, yes, food plays a role in that as well, because if you're eating bad food, you're going to be, your body's kind of going to mirror what you're putting into it. Your cells, everything that is you is an amalgamation of your brain's chemicals it's secreting and then all the food you've eaten. And if you aren't aware, every 7 years, every single cell in your whole body's been replaced. So every 7 years, you're essentially born again. The only thing that carries over every 7 years is your human experience. So every 7 years, if something bad happened to you 7 or more years ago, let it go. Because the only thing that's keeping it along right now is what your perception of it is. So anything that happened more than 7 years ago, I was 23. I would have been just getting out of college roughly. And I'm thinking where I was in my life 7 years ago. And anything that happened before that, I'm letting it go right now. And I charge you to do the same. So I'm going to close my eyes for a second. I'm not going to say anything for a second. If you do the same, you're welcome to join. We're just going to take about 30 seconds here. Okay. And it's gone. So the reason I say all that is for a lot of reasons, but at least when it comes to dealing with this chapter, it's, to me, I think it's not only important to let go, but it's also important to realize how far we've come. And the point I was making originally with this chapter and with what's going on here is that we personally, or like at least for me, it's like no one can tell you to go meditate and it actually mean anything. It's like people can tell you and it's like, oh yeah, sure. But until you truly, truly want to do it or know about it or learn it, you might as well be telling like a brick wall to go meditate. because it's just something that's someone has to want it like from themselves. Like it's like something inside of you. It's like your spirit, like whatever links you to previous generations, whatever links you to your previous self, which again, 7 years ago, like whatever links you to everyone, whatever that is inside of you that makes us all similar, whether it's like DMT or whether, you know, the spiritual molecule that's in all living matter on the planet, or whether it's how maybe you view it in terms of frequency and radio, or like in terms of frequency and like sound waves, and that like we're all vibrating at certain frequencies, and when you're in a bad mood, your body is putting off like a frequency. It's like when you're sad, you can just feel like when someone's sad. It's like, think about it like a dog. I look over at my dog over there, but it's like my dog, when someone comes to the house, then someone knocks and we don't know who it is, he will bark. But if someone knocks and we know who it is, he won't. Or say like dogs can sense stuff before humans can. It's because dogs see a different part of the electromagnetic spectrum, and they see things differently than we humans do. We humans only see like 3% of all the colors in the color spectrum. So the different animals see different portions of that color spectrum. And people say that when you're, it's like mood rings. It's like when your body, when you're scared, you put off a different color of like energy, like kind of exuding out of you. And so, yeah, it's like when someone's angry, you can sense when someone's angry. Oh, my MacBook is about to die. Don't want that to happen. Hold on. That could have been bad. My computer was about to die, but we saved it. Don't worry. We see. Yeah, so the deeper meaning of that computer, I'm saying. But no, it's just. Sorry, excuse me, it is late here. But yeah, with my dog, it's interesting. And with people in general, you can't tell someone to go meditate. I think I probably told maybe 30 people who complained to me on a daily, not daily, but like 30 people who I've kind of come across who have been like, oh, like I'm really stressed out about X, Y, and Z. And I'm like, do you work out? Do you ever meditate? Do you write down anything in journals? Are you involved with your community? Does anyone rely on you for anything? Do you have any hobbies? Do you have any friend groups? You know, there's like 100 things you can kind of like start shooting out where it's like, it's so easy for people to not have mentioned this in other videos. People know what they need to do. Even myself, it's like there's things I know I need to do, but it's almost just like sometimes you need someone to kind of push you into that direction. And it's weird because like with meditation, only you can push yourself in that direction. And I guess what I'll go ahead and close this out with, I don't like to keep these too long if the chapter's kind of short, but I wanted to let you guys in on this, and you guys can let me know in the comment section down below what your thoughts are on it. But as far as energy goes, and with like people in general, there's a good chance that if you're watching this video, it's like you know someone somewhere who kind of like it's like maybe like an ex-boyfriend or ex-girlfriend, or there's just people sometimes who will want things from you, and it's sometimes it's not even just like a financial thing or like a materialistic want. It's like a like to give an example, it's like if a girl, like in my case, it's like there's this girl I've been talking to, and it's like she's kind of like, I wouldn't say playing games, but it's like she's very much more quick to respond than I am to her. And there should be some videos up about this on my channel as well, like me just talking abstractly about it. But the point that I'm making with this, and the point that I didn't make in that video, is that you can safeguard your energy. Like if someone kind of like just seems like they just like, if you're asking questions about them, but they're not asking questions about you, and the conversation feels one-sided, and like you kind of feel like you're just entertaining them. If you feel that way, you are entertaining them. I'll leave it at that. Like if you feel like you are being an entertainer, and you are like, these people are getting more out of the conversation than you are, and it's consistently like that, and you've even mentioned to them like it's like that or you feel that way, and they don't make an attempt to change or adjust that, don't give them your energy. Don't waste your time with that. That's even like why I've kind of come to this YouTube platform as well, and I talk about this in a bunch of my videos, but it's like I came here because I just wanted to put my thoughts out in the world. It helps me feel better that I kind of in a way compiled them, and that people might get some sort of benefit out of them, in the immediate. But if not, I'm sure people can look back years and years later. But I just wanted to put my thoughts out on video onto the internet about all these things because there's so much craziness going on in the world that I think that's important to do. And I guess what I'll say, other than just like about this very, very brief chapter, just opening it up. Depend on nothing. Like Bruce Wayne, try and reset when you can. Try and truly live non-materialistically as much as possible. Do it even for a week. Just don't buy anything. Go grocery shopping before, but like just don't like be a consumer for a week. It's tough, believe it or not. Like you'll find yourself almost like addicted to swiping your card. I know I've been that way. So all we can do is work on that and just, safeguard your energy too. That's a big thing. That's my lesson for today. But thank you guys. That's all the time we got. Speaking of the lesson of the day, we're almost out of time for today. We got about 25 minutes till midnight. I gotta go get in a quick 100 push-ups before midnight and chug a little protein shake. We're trying to get in shape here too. I'll put some videos up of that eventually, but yeah, I just want to give my thoughts on that. Tomorrow we'll be back for another chapter. Tomorrow's chapter 10, The Circumstance is the Teaching. Sounds good, I know. I'll see you then. Thank you for hanging out. Thank you for listening. I appreciate you. I appreciate you spending your energy being here, and I promise you, I will never waste your energy. When you talk to me, I'm listening, baby. So you tell me. Let's get it popping. Anyway, much love. Take care. Be safe. And I will see you in the next one. Peace.